Welcome to everybody on behalf of AETCM. Today's topic we are going to discuss about ketamine, an intravenous anesthetic agent. The specialty of the ketamine is produce a different form of anesthesia called dissociative anesthesia. I will explain what is dissociative anesthesia subsequently. In brief, ketamine is an intravenous anesthetic agent. It produces dose-dependent effects. See, when you are given an optimal dose, anesthesia may be obtained. When you are giving in a reduction of the doses, you may get only analgesia. Patient will be arousable and unconsciousness will not be there. But the analgesia will be profound. See, this dose is called sub-anesthetic or sub-dissociative doses. What is meant by dissociative anesthesia? This term was coined in the year 1966 by Gwender Corson and Edward Domino. See, it is a trance-like cataleptic unconscious state, but at the same time, profound analgesia will also be present. See, the patient will have feeling of detachment from the self and environment. The eyes will be open, there may be nystagmus and gaze. Spontaneous respiration will also be maintained. Regarding the synthesis of ketamine, it was in the year 1962 in Michigan by Dr. Clavin Stevens, was working at Park Davis Laboratory, and it came to clinical practice in the year 1970. The chemical nature of ketamine, it's an analog of phencyclidine, which produces similar effect like ketamine. It is one of the cyclohexylamine compound. What are the forms of ketamine available? See, it has got two isomers, S isomer and R isomer. See, initially this preparation was a racemic mixture of both the isomers. Recently, they are isolating separately S isomer, and this is being manufactured and marketed. See, it is available in parenteral injection form as well as nasal spray. The main advantages of S-ketamine or S plus isomer. See, it is a preservative free form, so they can use in the neuraxial anesthesia, epidural, caudal or spinal. It produces intense analgesia nearly about 3 to 4 times that of the racemic mixture, so the dosage can be reduced. And it acts for a shorter duration, and the clearance is very rapid, and the salivation, increased salivation effect is not as it is in the racemic form. The emergency reactions also, the incidences are very much reduced. The nasal preparation is also available, and quickly the action will start. But at the same time, the caution with regard to the nasal preparation is, when you are inhaling directly, it crosses the cribriform plate. There are perforation in the cribriform plate. So it reaches the brain very quickly, and sometimes it may cause neurotoxicity. See, the product of ketamine is available for both IM and IV injection, and the IV infusion also we can be used. It's available in 2 strengths. That is 50 milligram per ml and 10 milligram per ml, and starting from 2 ml vial, 10 ml ampules and vials, both are available. For neuraxial anesthesia, there is S-ketamine preparation, which is available in the strength of 50 mg per ml, but it is available as 1 ml ampule, preservative free. See, the other preparations available are nasal encephalation for oral and sublingual lozenges, rectal route administration purpose also. Regarding the storage, it should always be kept in the temperature between 20 to 25 degrees centigrade, and it should be protected from light. Now we come to the mechanism of action of ketamine. See, it is an NMDA receptor antagonist. Told how the dissociative anesthesia is produced. Ketamine depresses some parts of thalamus and neurocortex, so which causes the unconsciousness and quietness. At the same time, it stimulates the lymphatic system, so there will be marked catalepsy, amnesia, analgesia. See, apart from NMDA receptors, ketamine also acts at opioid, noradrenergic, cholinergic, nicotinic and muscarinic receptors. We were telling in the beginning the sub-dissociative dosage, that is the lower dosage. Ketamine acts at the opioid receptors, and because of this action, profound analgesia is produced. It does not produce unconsciousness at the minimal dosages. And regarding the pharmacokinetics, see, as usual, after the administration of IV, it has got a distribution to various compartments. The first thing, it reaches the brain, so the blood concentration in the brain increases and it causes the induction. And then later from there, it is distributed to muscles, and lastly it is to the fat. The awakening occurs. One important point we have to keep in mind regarding ketamine is tachyphile axis. It is mainly for the analgesic effect. So it occurs when repeated usage of ketamine is undertaken. For example, burns patient, we will be daily dressing changing. So for a week, 10 days like that. So the tachyphile axis occurs, and we have to increase the dose to obtain the desired effect. Regarding the bioavailability, as administered by intravenous route, there will be 100% bioavailability, and in intramuscular route, it will be 93%. And by mouth or sublingual or rectal, it will be around 30% at the maximum. Okay. So we have already discussed about the pharmacodynamics of this thing. Okay. Apart from that, when we come to the protein binding, it is getting nearly 12 to 47% of protein binding. The rest will be free form, which will have action on the receptors. And the metabolism is mainly happening in the liver by the process N-demethylation. So CYP3A4 and CYP2B6 and CYP2C9 are the enzymes which will be helping in the metabolism. And the metabolites, norketamine, dehydronorketamine, hydroxynorketamine, and its conjugates. See, all are excreted via the kidney. See, when the hepatic flow is deranged or decreased, the ketamine metabolism may take long time. So the dosages has to be adjusted accordingly. Regarding the elimination hop time, the ketamine action hop time will be 2.5 to 3 hours. And its metabolite, norketamine, takes nearly 12 hours. And the duration of action, when you are administering as intramuscular route, see, it is between half an hour to 2 hours. when it is used for the nasal free insufflation, nearly about 45 minutes to 60 minutes. When oral preparations will act nearly for about 6 hours or more than 6 hours. So the excretion of the drug happens mostly through the urine, the metabolites, and unchanged fraction, nearly 3%, is excreted in the urine. So the renal failure has got no role or in the elimination of this one. This drug is partially dialysable. When the overdosages are suspected, partial dialysis will be possible. Regarding the drug interactions, there are two things. One, ketamine action will be increased or the ketamine action will be reduced. This happens because of the increased plasma concentration of ketamine or decreased plasma concentration of ketamine. Some of the drugs like diazepam, when co-administered along with ketamine, will increase the ketamine plasma level in the blood. On the contrary, drugs like rifampicin, phenytoin, phenobarbital, they will have the opposite effect. With these drugs, ketamine concentration level will be reduced. See, when we are using SNRI antidepressants and the MAOI, the most important precaution you have to remember is the increased adrenergic activity, that is the increased BP, heart rate, palpitation, arrhythmias, all things may be happen. When ketamine is injected, when the patient is taking alcohol, coming to an emergency department with the trauma, he has consumed alcohol, the ketamine action will be potentiated. See, other drugs which will increase the sedative action of ketamine are benzodiazepines, opioids, barbiturates and phenothiazines. So when these drugs are concomitantly used with ketamine, both the drugs dosages should be reduced, otherwise side effects may be serious. See, benzodiazepines commonly co-administered with ketamine to avert the emergence phenomenon. So, but benzodiazepines will reduce the effect of ketamine. So, along with benzodiazepines, little extra dose of ketamine should be administered. See, ketamine can be used along with conventional antidepressants. There are not much reactions. Ketamine itself is having an antidepressant action. So, how to administer ketamine? See, always any anesthetic induction agent or sedative drugs, it is better you have every backup for managing all the cardiovascular and respiratory complications arising. So, always should be administered by a trained person who has got an exposure and experience in the advanced airway management, ventilatory support and resuscitation. The drug administration should not be pushed as a bolus. It should be administered slowly over a period of 30 to 60 seconds. What will happen if you are administering in a bolus at a rapid rate? So the pressure responses will be increased, sudden increase in heart rate, BP, with its consequent effects. And it may also lead on to respiratory depression or apnea. Both respiratory depression and apnea duration may vary. It may be short-lived for a few seconds or 1 or 2 minutes. So during this period, you have to take care of the ventilation aspect. And every drug, especially the anesthetic drugs, sedative drugs or analgesic, when we are giving intravenous route, it should be always titrated on individual patient's needs and response. When you are giving ketamine, still the pharyngolaryngeal reflexes are pressured, if not completely, at least partially pressured. Any stimulation in the oropharynx or laryngeal region may suddenly lead on to laryngospasm or bronchospasm. So, an attempt to view the vocal cords, that is laryngoscopy, or an intubation attempt should not be done with ketamine alone. So, the patient should have an adequate muscle relaxant used. Then only we can able to avert these complications. When you are administering ketamine, you have to keep in mind one more important factor, that there will be increased salivation and increased oropharyngeal secretions, so which will be causing the airway obstruction, which may cause aspiration, or the trickling of the sensitive larynx may lead on to laryngeal spasm or bronchial spasm. So this can be averted by using either atropine or glycopyrrolate pre-medication. See, as the atropine is also producing tachycardia, so instead of atropine, glycopyrrolate is an apt choice for a drying agent. Okay. And the suction should be ready, and suctioning should be carefully done without stimulating the oropharyngeal and hypopharyngeal regions. So once you want to discharge the patient after using ketamine as an outpatient for some procedure, observe the patient in the observation area till the patient completely recovered, and always send an adult responsible person accompanying the patient. See, the most important thing, don't forget, the drug is contraindicated in children of age less than 3 months. So now the dosages. So even though books describe the dosages based on kilogram body weight, the dosages will vary according to so many factors like age, whether the patient is child, adult or geriatric. According to the indications, what purpose we are using the ketamine, whether it is only for analgesia or sedation or procedural sedation, or as an induction agent for RSI, or a maintenance and induction agent for anesthesia. So many factors we have to keep in mind. And the ketamine is also used for certain therapeutic purposes, as in the case of status epilepticus, status asthmaticus, and depression. So based on these things, the dosage has to be accordingly adjusted. And the deciding factors about the dosage are other factors like duration of action we want. That is, the procedure may last only half an hour, or it may last for 2 hours or more. So the duration of action desired, and patient's clinical status, that is hemodynamic compromises, intracranial pressure, intraocular pressure, renal and kidney status, all these things. And what route you are going to administer the drug, whether intramuscular or intravenous or by oral or nasal or rectal. Apart from that, modes of administration, whether you are administering as an IV bolus or IV infusion, and co-administered drugs like sedatives, analgesics and hypnotics. All these things will be having an impact of the dosage you are selecting. So individual titration is the best safe way. Okay. So arbitrarily there are prescribed dosages for adult patients for the induction purpose. It may be either rapid sequence intubation or in general anesthesia induction. So we can give the drug in two routes. One is IM or IV. The IM route may be chosen when used in a small side not permitting to have an IV access, or an adult who is an agitated patient not able to get a vein. So the IM dosage is 4 to 5 milligram per kilogram body weight. So the onset of action when administered in the intramuscular route is 3 to 5 minutes, and the effect will last for about 30 to 45 minutes. The main disadvantages of IM route administration are the incidences of vomiting are more, and the duration of action is prolonged, and the recovery time will be delayed. So next we go for the intravenous route for the purpose of induction, either in the rapid sequence intubation or general anesthesia. See, the dosage is reduced from IM doses nearly half to 1/4, that is 1 to 2 milligram per kilogram. Onset of action occurs within 60 seconds and the duration is about 10 to 20 minutes. For analgesia without loss of consciousness, that is, here we don't want the patient to go unconsciousness, but at the same time we want to achieve analgesia, that is pain relief. So here also we can choose either IV or IM route. So we need not have to go for an induction usage, induction doses. So the dosages can be lowered. So this is called a sub-anesthetic or sub-dissociative dose. So again, this dosage depends upon whether you use ketamine alone or you want to combine with some other sedatives, analgesics. So when ketamine alone is used, intravenous loading dose is 0.2 milligram to 0.5 milligram per kilogram body weight. It should be administered slowly over a period of 3 to 5 minutes. See, the dosage has been reduced to 1/4 to less than half of the intravenous induction dosages. Then it can be maintained by infusion, for which the recommended dosage is 0.5 milligram per kilogram body weight per hour. The next is when you are going to combine ketamine with drugs like benzodiazepines or opiates. So the dose reduction of both the drugs should be done appropriately. This will be according to the patient's response and the patient's status and hemodynamic alterations. Okay. Then there is a combination of ketamine plus propofol in the ratio of 1:1. That is called ketofol. See, usually ketamine increases the blood pressure and increases the heart rate. This effect will be countered by propofol. And another combination will be midazolam and ketamine. So this combination will reduce the incidences and severity of emergence phenomenon which occurs because of ketamine. See, in the military, in the war field, when the soldiers are wounded, so immediate pain relief. So many other drugs may cause so many other side effects. But the ketamine in the minimum dosage, sub-anesthetic or sub-dissociative doses, give adequate pain relief. At the same time, the person will be conscious without feeling any pain. So the routes administered are here IM, intravenous, and intranasal preparations also available. Sub-dissociative doses in military, they do not calculate in terms of weight basis. The initial dose is 50 milligram. This can be repeated every 30 to 45 minutes. So this is for the intramuscular and intranasal route. For the initial intravenous dosage is 20 milligram. It will be repeated once in every 20 minutes or as the patient needs. So intranasal administration may be either via nasal atomizer or with a syringe. For this, there are both racemic as well as S forms are available. When we use a racemic mixture, 3 to 6 milligram per kg body weight is a recommended dose. When you are using S-ketamine isomer preparation, see 1/3 of the doses, that is 2 milligram per kilogram body weight, because this is nearly 4 times having the analgesic potency of the racemic mixture. Next, coming to the procedural sedation. Here again, the drug is being given either IM or IV when the IV line is not accessible. So initially the patient will be given IM. Once the patient becomes drowsy, then they may get the IV access also. By IM route for procedural sedation, the dosage recommended is 2 to 5 milligram per kilogram. So this is useful for short procedures. The main disadvantage is delayed onset and delayed recovery, longer duration of action. See, intravenous route for procedural sedation, the dosage is 0.2 to 0.5 milligram per kilogram body weight. The maximum it may go up to 1 milligram per kilogram body weight. So coming to the therapeutic uses, we discussed it may be used in bronchial asthma, acute exacerbation or status asthmaticus, but it is not a primary agent in these conditions. It's used only as a secondary agent. As an IV bolus, initial dose is given for immediate action. The dosage is 0.1 to 0.2 milligram per kilogram. Then for maintenance, infusion will be continued and the dosage is 0.25 to 0.5 milligram per kilogram body weight per hour. The another situation where ketamine is used is refractory status epilepticus. When all other drugs could not control the convulsions, as a third line agent, ketamine is preferred. Here, initial dosage for an immediate onset of action, it is varying from 0.5 milligram to 4.5 milligram per kilogram body weight. And maintenance for longer duration achieved by intravenous infusion, 5 milligram per kilogram body weight per hour. For the refractory status epilepticus, so this drug should be selected only when all other drugs are not able to control the convulsions. So that is third line. It is not immediately switched over to this drug. And recently, there are papers and accepted ketamine usage for immediate management of depression or suicidal ideation, because the action starts immediate and the antidepressant effect is also immediate. So here it can be given initial dose intravenously 0.15 to 0.4 milligram per kilogram, but it is given over a period of 10 minutes. So further maintenance by infusion intravenous route, the dosage is 2 to 5 milligram per kilogram per hour. 2 to 5 milligram per kilogram per hour. The improvement occurs within 2 hours and the duration may last for nearly 24 hours. For regular usage, ketamine in depression, nasal spray of S-ketamine is approved for usage in the year 2019 by the United States. So now, so far we have discussed about the dosages for the adult patients. Now we discuss about the ketamine dosage in the pediatric age group. So before going to the dosage, you should remember important contraindications for ketamine usage in pediatric patients. See, babies less than 3 months of age, contraindicated, because the liver metabolism is so much diminished. And any oropharyngeal surgical procedures without intubation, endotracheal intubation, and head trauma or other contraindications in the pediatric age group. Here again, the intramuscular dose is 2 to 5 milligram per kilogram body weight. Within 3 to 5 minutes, the onset will occur. The duration will last for about 30 to 40 minutes. Intravenous route 1 to 2 milligram per kilogram body weight. For infusion in the pediatric age group, the initial drug administration is by intravenous bolus 2 milligram per kilogram body weight and further continued by infusion. Here the dosage varies according to the duration. For in the first 20 minutes, 10 milligram per kilogram per hour is the dosage for infusion. And for the next 20 minutes, the dosage will be reduced from 10 to 5 to 7 milligram per kilogram body weight per hour. And for the next 1 hour, the dosage will further reduce to 4 milligram per kilogram per hour. And thereafter, 3.5 milligram per kilogram per hour. And for neuraxial anesthesia, caudal, epidural or spinal anesthesia, esketamine is the preferred one because it is having a much potent action and it is preservative free. See, the other routes of administration of ketamine are by oral route, rectal route and nasal route. For nasal racemic mixture dosage 3 to 6 milligram per kilogram and esketamine dosage 2 milligram per kilogram. Oral dosage is 5 to 6 milligram per kilogram. The main disadvantage of oral administration is more incidence of nausea and vomiting. So which can be prevented by pre-treatment with ondansetron. And by rectal route, 5 to 10 milligram per kilogram body weight is the rectal drug. So far we have discussed about the ketamine, the metabolism, important actions, and what all the various routes we can be administering the drug. So, regarding the indications, contraindications, ketamine advantages, disadvantages, adverse drug reactions and side effects, all these things we will be discussing in the next episode. Thanks to everybody for patiently listening.